Salvation is here. You can put away your binge watching, chocolate scoffing, wine guzzling, self-isolation, humdrum life to one side for one more week, because the Seventh Heaven crew are in town and we invite you to dive across the pearly line into the clouds and into the one-stop celestial stop shop for all things Sevens. Oh, we're back.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Get to breathe, Burnsy. It's hot out. I don't want you parting out.
Do you know what? I've been bored shitless for a week and now I've got two people to talk to you, and we got a special guest in the cloud. So I'm fizzing at the moment. I'm fizzy. I'm trying to contain it, but I'm fizzing.
Nice, Burnsy. What's your dive then? What's your dive into the Seventh Heaven? How do you dive? Your single arm ball transfer? Are you diving high? Are your knee sliding? You're probably a knee slide, aren't you?
I'm a slide along the thigh with it tucked into her hands, like not a real dive. Too scared. I don't really have the core stability either for that.
What are you, Chippy? I'm not seeing you score many tries. So.
No, I don't. It's normally because I've so far passed everyone. It's normally a one hand dot down. I have tried one dive, over rotated. You know when you see people take the pictures and they go like completely horizontal. I got up there and then the top half weighed down. And then the belly weighed me up down. And then it was like belly ball. I nearly dropped it. I was like, I'm never doing that again.
I think as a young London Irish fan, I was scarred for the rest of my life after Leguizamon. Do you remember him when he went for the big dive in the St. Patrick's Day game and spilled the ball? Do you remember that back in the day in the Premiership?
Criminal, that. There was also one from the Hong Kong Sevens that's been...
Yeah, the Japanese geezer.
Japanese lad. Yeah, he does a break, gives it the big one to the crowd. Dives, dash, flops out under his arm. He's got his head in his hands. Oh, it hurts just talking about it.
Who's the biggest showboater in the game at the moment when it comes to try scoring?
What, that, like as in diving or just... Tom Bowen loves a needless dive for no reason in our team. He loves a needless dive. He injured himself in Twickenham. He was in the corner. All he had to do was slide it in, give it a big dive, dislocated his shoulder.
No, that was epic. That was worth it. Yeah, he might not say that. He had to have surgery, I think. But...
Oh, no, it was a hell of a finish.
It was a hell of a finish. I don't think he would have got in with a slide. Anyway, that's worth looking up on. Phil Burgess is a renowned bad diver. Awful. Can't get it right.
He's a knee
dive.
Just knees digging in. Knees digging into the ground.
So come on, boys. Tell me, what have you been up to since we last convened here in the clouds?
This is going to be a very short segment of the pod. Go, Chippy. What have you been up to, mate?
I have been target shooting with an air rifle. I've been chipping golf balls. I've been lifting weights in the garden. I've been walking the dog, socially distancing. And that's about it, really. Trying to keep the baby alive as well. Little baby Rudy. He's been pooing and crying.
The Isle of Wight pentathlon.
That's it. Just keep the baby alive at the end. Is as long as you do that, you're winning.
What about you, Mitch?
Very little. I've been doing a fair bit of reading, actually. I've got a system now. I get two books on the go. So I read one in the day and then one in the evening.
At the same time? Surely the sentences don't make sense. Do you read across?
Very good, Rich. Other than that, just been in the garden. I've actually been working on my juggling. So I'm trying to progress from three balls to four balls at the moment. It's actually quite difficult, four-ball juggling. Little challenge for the pod listeners.
I saw you.
Why are you giggling, Richard?
I just know there's one person in the household that's great at four ball juggling.
Shout out,
Flora Lucy B.
Luckily, she's not a listener of the pod.
I saw you doing some inventive kicking practice in the back garden by the power of social media, which was a nice step up after your press up effort in the weeks before via England Rugby's social media. Talk us through the kicking, Mitch.
I'm building my social media as the weeks go on. That or shutting it down. I haven't decided which yet. Like Chippy, trying to keep the training going in the garden. So doing a bit of physical stuff. But I also set up the kicking net yeah, get a few strikes on. I've actually gone to the next level.
Sounds bigger than it is.
Can you explain to people who haven't seen it, who for some reason beyond my comprehension, they don't follow you on social media?
Well, it can't be anyone out there, but I've hung an old sheet, basically an old blanket, over the washing line and pegged it on there. And I've been kicking into it, but it's quite a small target. So if I slice it, which I do frequently, I will lose balls. I've actually taken it to the next level, and I'm a bit ashamed to admit this, but I ordered off Amazon, and it arrived today, a 6-foot strip of artificial like grass matting, so I don't ruin the lawn with my strikes.
I've got that for my golf as well, mate.
Is that sad?
No, that's professional, Tom.
That's professional. I think
training.
Tax deductible as well. Smart. Go on, Burnsy. What have you been doing, my son?
What have I been doing? Not an awful lot. Do you know what I've been doing? I've been indulging in the preposterous dance of deception with the treats cupboard in my flat on a daily basis. Now, I actually refer to this as glove boxing. I think people in isolation might have gone through this, but you know when you go on a long drive?
I think that's something else, mate.
You know when you go on a long drive or a medium drive or maybe even a short drive, usually there's some treats in the glove box. Like if you're in your dad's car when you're a nipper, it's a bag of mints. But as you get older, you get your own car. Maybe you got some Percy Pigs in there. And you'll open up the treats. You take a couple out. You'll pop them in the glove box, close it up and say to yourself, great, I've had a couple of treats. Off we go on the drive. I'm not going to be going near them again. And for the duration of the drive, you're just constantly reaching. You're dipping straight back in. And by the end of the drive, you've eaten them all. Why have you not started with the treats out by the handbrake from the word go? It's because you're lying to yourself. You're like, I'm going to be disciplined. I'm going to be abstemious. I'm not going to eat the whole bag on the journey. But by the end of it, you do. And so I call that glove boxing. And I've just been doing it in my house. There'll be a packet of biscuits in the cupboard. And I'll be like, oh, do you know what? I'm going to treat myself to a mid-afternoon biscuit. So I'll get up, I'll have one, tie it up, close the cupboard, go and sit down. And I end up doing 20 up-down reps to the cupboard and back. And before you know it, the packet of biscuits is gone. So that's what I've been up to in isolation.
Mate, that sounds a lot like a therapy confession. Hi, I'm Joe Burns, and I'm a glove boxer.
I'm a secret dipper. Burnsy, your problem is, who takes one biscuit? You're talking 3 or 4 biscuits minimum at a time, and then that's you. Mm. You take 3, you eat 2, you look at 1, you have a bit of your tea, you finish it off, a couple of dunks, your last biscuit. Oh, yeah, nice. You don't take one. Who takes one? Criminals take one.
I think you're doing yourself a bit of self-love by indulging. Mm. I think you've got to in lockdown. Don't fight the battles that are unnecessary.
That's how deep the deception has gone that I'm taking one now. I mean, I felt like I needed to share that with the pod listeners after the crumpet confessions from last week with you, Mitch. Just in the interest of honesty, in the interest of transparency in this
day. Get rid of that shame, Burnsy. Get rid of that shame. There's no place for it. You do what you want.
But other than glove boxing around the flat, we have all been communicating together and we've lined up a pretty sweet guest today, haven't we?
It's good.
Feel like
it's
the good. Pressure's on big time.
This said is the yes, first time I'm still I've been properly nervous for the pod recording.
I'm so nervous for Chippy's reputation because he's the one who's teed this up.
Oh, yeah, that's mate, just made that clear now.
Imagine if he just doesn't ring me, ring us. Oh gosh. Oh no. No, I've complete faith in Speedstick. PBake, he's a top lad. I'm sure he'll come on. I'm looking forward to speaking to him and chatting all things Sevens.
He's a proper legend of the game as well. I think it's fair to say that. Like he's changed the game a bit.
Yeah, unbelievable, Jeff.
We'll save that for his out.
Very, very exciting. But at the moment, Chippy's in the foyer of the cinema. He's got 2 ticket stubs. He's already bought the popcorn and he's nervously looking at his watch, wondering if she's going to turn up.
It is the adverts and I've already had half the popcorn. I'm worried. Is it going to last?
You've gone for the head boy look, Mitch.
Well, I just wanted to go smart, at least on the top half. I won't show you what's underneath. But I've I've not been making much effort. I think that's a characteristic of lockdown that I've been seeing a lot on social media as well, that people aren't getting dressed properly. And I'm in that camp for sure. So I thought I'd take this opportunity to actually sort of dress up for the occasion, because it's probably the biggest occasion of my week.
You look like Chris Kamara. Someone's been sent off there, Chris.
What's happened?
There's been a red card, Chris. Have you seen it?
Has it happened?
That's a goal. Yeah, the keen, there'll be keen listeners slash watchers of the pod, if you go to YouTube and watch this episode, they'll recognize the tie from part of my history. Leave that to the watchers to tweet us or Instagram us about.
University of Biting. I never forgive Bristol.
Don't want to dredge that up again, Chippy. I know it's painful memories for you.
The good news is, chaps, is that we've been getting plenty of action on social media. Lots of questions coming in for our guest for this episode, and a few more followers looking very lively on Instagram and Twitter and on all the platforms that we broadcast on. So iTunes, Acast, Spotify, YouTube, and I'm sure there's a couple of others that it's being distributed to that I don't have the technical ability to know exactly where it's going. But if you enjoy this podcast, then we'd love you to like, subscribe, and leave a review. If you don't enjoy the podcast, I don't want to hear your reviews, so just keep it to yourself. But we'd really appreciate the love as far as likes and subscriptions go.
I think if you really don't enjoy the podcast and you need to vent, then just DM Burnsy and he can take the flak, because it's mostly his fault anyway.
At Burnsy Drama. Right, without further ado, boys, shall we get our bit of star-spangled stardust here on the show?
Yeah, let's get him on.
Dialing in all the way from the USA. Here he is, ladies and gentlemen. It's Perry Baker in Seventh Heaven. One night in heaven, one night in heaven. Hey, thanks so much for joining us in Seventh Heaven, up in the clouds.
No doubt. Thanks for having me, man.
PBake, baby.
Big Rich.
Mate, do you know what? We're pumped to have you on the podcast, but if anything, the overriding feeling is relief that you haven't stood Chippy up, because he's been like, nah, my boy PBake's going to come through for me. Don't you worry.
You already know, Big Rich, I'm going to come through, baby.
Yes, PBake. I knew you would. I was so worried.
Never in
PBake
doubt.
Puts out. So, mate, how's it going over in the States? How's isolation treating you, Perry?
Man, it's a madhouse over here, man. Everything's closed down. Can't go nowhere. I have to wear a mask when you go outside now. So it's been tough, man. Just been sitting in the house bored, man. Just playing Fortnite all the time, man.
PBake, talk to us then. What's going on with the USA at the moment? We've seen there's been a lot of like budget cuts, and now PBake, it looks like the USA have completely cut funding for the sevens and everything. What's going on?
No, they haven't actually. It's kind of like the business side of the game, that you have to do this type of stuff where you try and clean house and get everything good for the future. So everything is ticking and running pretty smooth. So right now I feel like we'll be in a good place when the season start back up, you know, but right now it's just something that they had to do. And because of the COVID, it made it come quicker.
Right.
Fair enough. So does that change anything for you guys thinking ahead to next year? Now the Olympics has been moved. How did you guys feel about that? Obviously, we chatted about this last week. It's a bit of a bummer for the guys who are hoping to go this summer to Tokyo. But well, how do you feel about that? And how are the guys feeling about that?
I mean, you got your pros and cons with it. I mean, you got guys who were looking to be done after the Olympic Games. And now everything's been pushed back, which is kind of cool, though, because we had a few guys that was banged up here and there, and we needed them, everyone, to be healthy. So it's kind of, you kind of got your good parts out of that, because everyone gets to be healthy. I mean, we might have Falau back by then after he broke his leg last season. You know, we might have Neymar back after he just tore his ACL. So it's all the good side of it is that we'll have everyone back and everyone healthy.
Hey, you mentioned getting a few boys back and healthy. We've seen a bit more of an experimental side for the US this year. So has it been good to experiment and to discover a few new talents, try out some fresh combinations, give yourself a bit more variety when it comes to selection time when the Olympics comes around next year, which obviously isn't what everyone was planning for?
Right, spot on, man. It's just, And we're trying to get the game to grow here too. So, you know, like these guys that are here now, like myself, we won't be here forever playing, you know. So we need to have a new generation coming in. And some of the boys that stepped up this year for us, they have been in the, been around us for like 3 years now. So it's good to see them boys get a shot and really go out there and show themselves. So, and it'll be good, like you said, for when it's time to pull for the Olympics, because everyone's going to be fighting for a spot. So that competition is what we're all about. And so it's cool to see these guys getting a chance and come out there and compete. So it was all good.
Sorry, Mitch. No, go on. You go, Mitch.
Sorry, mate. You've had your question, Burnsy. Piss off. I was just going to say, man, on that, like, obviously me and Chippy kind of, and yourself, we're kind of in that older age bracket that you're talking about. How's that for you, thinking another year? You feeling good for another year? Because you'll be, what are you, 33 this summer, 34 next year. So obviously still flying from what we can see. But how's the body feeling like? Day-to-day, I mean, training and looking ahead to next year?
I feel like I'll be fine, man, just because this big break right now and the coaches know my body and I know my body and just taking it easy. You know, I mean, it is a long season if the season actually takes off in September. You know, that's 14 tournaments and that would be a lot on someone's body. But having these young guys who stepped up last year and stuff, we can let those guys go out there and get more games under their belt so they feel comfortable. But I just feel like I just take one tournament at a time, one game at a time. I feel like I'll be fine, though. Honestly, I said I'd do another 2 or 3 years. Like, I want to go to another World Cup, you know, at the Olympic Games. So I think I'd be fine, man. I think they'll manage me pretty well. And it's just good
That's
to
great
have
to hear.
The other guys behind, too, to come in and step up.
Nice.
Who, PBake, so all the young lads coming through, who's going to be the next PBake?
Oh, my goodness.
There will never be a new PBake.
There we go. Tell him, Mitch.
PBake, I know when you do your press, I know you say that I'm the white PBake. So who's coming through that's going to be who's going to try and take the number 11 shirt in a couple of years? Who should we watch out for?
Jeez, I have no idea. I just hope someone come in and be better than me, honestly. I mean, just take it to a whole nother level with their skills and stuff. But I don't know. I like the young boys like Tala. He was on the series for a little while until he hurt his shoulder, had to have shoulder surgery. I like Nemo a lot. He's really good. Like, he's going to be like another Falau Nua, which is great for the program just because of his dynamics and his skills, and he's been growing. So that's a few of the boys that's been around, you know. I'm just excited to see where we can actually leave it off and where guys can actually take it, pick up and take it.
You mentioned about the next gen and wanting them to be better. I know that when you were looking at starting playing rugby, that Cecil Africa was a big inspiration for you because you looked at your size and your shape and you were told for a long, long time that you were too small to play the game, but obviously proving everyone otherwise. Are you hoping to inspire that kind of player to come into the game?
Oh, for sure. I mean, if you look at a game of rugby and stuff, it's changing all the way around, you know, and it's been changing. And I just want to be able to inspire anyone, actually. If you're big and slow, if you're big and fast, whatever the case may be, just want to be able to let you know that you can believe in yourself and you can do it. Because I was told for the longest that I wouldn't be able to make it. Even when I was trying to go to the NFL, they were like, man, you're going to get broke up so fast. And in my mind, I was like, ain't no way that's going to happen. Then same thing when I was talking about playing rugby. It's like, you don't look like a rugby player. And I still get that to this day. Like, guys be like, when I think of rugby players, they always think of, like, the 15-size boys. Everyone's, like, really huge. But I'm like, no, that's not the case. And I'm like, and it always comes down to your heart, though. So whoever just believe in themselves and have that dog in them, then they can make it.
Yeah, do you look at guys the size of Mitch and think, like, yeah, I can make it. I can make it size. It just doesn't matter.
Nah, because you look at Mitch, though, like, he has a hard job, though, because he's the sweeper. So whenever someone breaks, it's like, imagine Chippy breaks free and he's running at Mitch. Mitch got to stick his head in there, but he has that heart to do it. He has that dog to do it. So
that's Perry, believe me, most of the time, I'd rather not do it, man. I'd rather not.
every time I break through against America and I run and I see Falau Nua, I think, oh, I'm going to sit him down. And every time he dips a shoulder and absolutely smokes me. How is that boy such a big hitter for such a small lad?
He's a butterball. That's why, man. He's short, but he's solid, man.
That's it. Hey, PBake, you spoke about 15s players. Have you ever been tempted to play 15s?
I have. I said that after I retire from sevens, I want to dabble in 15s for a little bit. I know they had started a professional league here called the MLR. Major League Rugby, and I wanted to play a little bit. I always tell people I didn't play, but I have, but it was like so unreal because like everyone was like really big and super slow. And like, if you ever think about 15s, they're never running it out from their own try line. But the team I played for, which is Daytona Coconut, they would just pass the ball out wide and just say run from our own try line. And I'm like, when I actually saw 15s play, like, that's not the game of 15s. And it's the same thing when I went to Tiger Rugby and I played for 15s there. They're just like, okay, we need to score something. PBake, they just say, why? Just throw it wide. And it's just how we run. So I never
thought that's not a, 15s. That's not a bad tactic.
It's not the game of 15s itself, though, you know? So I just like, man, yeah. I haven't played. I just played with people who, like, just jumped off the couch and wanted to play club rugby still, you know?
Yeah, so who would you go play for in the MLR? Because they're gonna get two new franchises. They're, I think, LA and Dallas, although correct. Colorado have just gone under today, which is so weird because that's such a
yes, they still have every other event going on. I just the COVID messed everything up, man. And but I would like to stay close to San Diego because my family's here, of course. But so LA would be definitely a good spot. San Diego Leeds would be a good spot. I don't know. I just want to go and see where I fit in best at, where I can help out the most.
Benzi, do you want to do some questions from the public?
Yeah, we had a few people, didn't we, sending questions.
Yeah, I've totally misplaced them.
Wait a second.
I've got one. Sorry, in the meantime. Unprofessional. PBake, honestly.
In the meantime, Perry, I've got some.
Ultimate professional. Welcome to 7 Heaven,
Perry. At least someone's
Perry.
Keeping this podcast together, Benzi.
Jesus.
So I actually asked my family on WhatsApp, my family group. I was like, you got any questions you want me to ask Perry? Because they're fans of Sevens and obviously they're fans of you. My mum actually still remembers chatting to you in Dubai. And I'm sure you remember it, of course,
easy.
As well.
Easy,
she still talks about it. Yeah, I know. I'm not sure what went down, but...
oh my God.
Right, I'll start you off with an easy question though. So you're one of the few players that warms up with headphones on. I know a few guys in your team do, but not many other teams do. What kind of tunes have you got going on in there?
It just depends on my mood. Like, honestly, it just always varies. Sometimes, like, if I feel like I'm in, like, a funk and I really need to get uplifted or whatnot, I listen to gospel music. A lot of the times, I'm listening to Kevin Gates because, like, that's my guy, man. Like, Kevin always get me going. Sometimes I listen to some country music, you know. So it just depends, honestly. Sometimes I like listening. I got a playlist called Party Boy. So I listen to some upbeat like techno music, man. It just depends, man. It's just
Party Boy Perry.
Going.
The Party Boy from Jackass.
Yeah, you can say that.
That's it, PBake. Just a silly one. Who has got the worst personal hygiene on the USA Sevens team?
Oh my God.
Stitch them up.
Who's the stinky bloke?
Can I plead the fifth?
Yeah, you can. You can go for that.
Oh man, a few of my teammates have someone in mind though. They have someone in mind, but I ain't gonna do that.
speaking of your teammates, I've got a question from one of your teammates who got in touch. He said, why are you so soft?
Why am I so soft? Who would say that? I have no idea who would say that. I don't know. You got to find soft, you know? You got to find soft.
It was someone who's just had a back operation. We'll put it that way.
Oh, my gosh. I know. That's what you're talking about. He just messaged me the other day, too.
He's trying to get into your P-Bank.
Hey, he only says that because he gets so pissed when he can't blow me off for a breakdown or whatnot. So that's always why he's saying that. And I always give him crap about it.
Yes. Oh, so Ben Pinkelman, you're saying Ben Pinkelman can't get you off a breakdown?
Of course, you got to ask him. When I tell him, he has to be for even when we do combat stuff, we wrestle. I always say you have to be at least 220 or above to wrestle me. And when Pinky comes over there, he can never get me, so he always get frustrated. And I always rub it in his face.
So you're harder than Ben Pinkelman. That's what we're saying.
Hey, what Mitch told you? I'm one of the older boys. I'm 33 years old, and here he is already having back surgery. He hasn't hit 30 yet.
PBake, that comes in quite nicely about your team dynamic, that you're a pretty diverse bunch of individuals in the USA Eagles team, obviously led by Mike Friday as well, who's an Englishman, but I guess that exchange is a good example that you can take strength from that diversity, and you guys draw on that a lot. Is that fair to say?
Yeah. I mean, it just took a lot to get us to where we are, though, man, because like you said, we're so diverse. Everyone's background is different. People come from different areas. So it was just really tough to get it all there. But once we got it there, we started clicking. Like, if you think about it, like, you try and bring, like, 23 guys together who are totally different backgrounds and everything, and then you have an English coach who comes over to America and try and learn the cultures of each and every one, that's tough to do. You know, so we just did a lot of trying to figure out who we are as individuals and then as a team and collectively come together and form the dogs of who we are now. So, yeah, we do look at that all the time, like how we communicate with each other and everything. So, yeah, like this year we can look at it and we say we were so inconsistent, like we wasn't consistent at all. Like we'll show glimpses of the good stuff from last year and everything. And this year is just like communicating well with each other, like how to get back to that. Like we've been in these things before, overcoming this adversity. So it was pretty cool though, because I remember several times we had so many blow-ups with each other. It'd be crazy. But now it's like we can have those blow-ups. It's like a talk, you know, like that brother talk, like let's get it in gear, let's go. So it's pretty cool, man. And you got to enjoy the moments, man.
100%.
I know you've probably been asked this question a lot, but in terms of that team dynamic, like two of the biggest names that have come out of the USA Sevens, probably of all time, are you and probably Carlin is the other one. And you're both the speedsters. You're obviously both two of the top wingers in the world, and you're both in the same team. Like, do you guys push each other? Like, do you work well together? Like, how does that dynamic go down? Man, obviously, it's been brought up recently as well, because you guys both tipped over the 200 try mark. Well done, by the way.
Yeah.
Congratulations. I mean,
appreciate that, guys. Really appreciate that. It really goes back and forth because Carlin's very competitive. Very competitive. Same here. I'm very competitive. So we always push each other here and there. Like sometimes, like I want to play center and he wants to play wing. And that's what we want to do on the series. So we always play together. But then some of the boys will be like, that's not fair. You guys got to break it up. So then when we break it up and we know that we need to push each other, we'll set challenges for each other and really battle each other out there. So it's pretty cool all around. And guys love to see that too. They like to see that when we're on that level.
For sure.
I don't like to see you at center and wing. Not for me, thank you. Just one at a time on the pitch, please. That's enough.
Yeah, Perry, can you tell me exactly what's going through your mind when you're licking your lips, when you look up and you see that Chippy's defending on the outside and the ball's coming your way? you're just spoiled for choice.
Well, and I always see that. I'm always thinking like how far I actually have to run. And if it's far, I'm like, geez, I got to drop the hammer early so they don't chase over. If it's not too far, then I just run normal kind of deal just to get away. But I like it just for the simple fact. I know it's an easy try.
You just called me a fat guy. Jeez, P-Bake. No, last time you're coming on.
Yes.
Hey, no.
That's a soundbite for the pod. Right now.
Oh, gosh.
But, mate, right. It's really interesting, though, getting into that mindset for someone like you, because like when you first came in and you were on the wing and you were scoring awesome tries and stuff, but then as the years have gone on, you've added so many strings to your bow, like kickoff being the obvious one, but also like defensively. And you're kind of, I've seen you working on your kicking stuff as well in Instagram. So when you're adding all these skills, firstly, how do you motivate yourself to do that? Like what's the driving force? But also when you're then into the game, like what's your kind of mindset? Are you just feeling like you're in it, or are you thinking your way through those things?
So the first thing that's driving me is I always wanted to be the best at everything I've done. Like even when we have to run laps when I was in elementary, when you go out to PE and you have to run a lap, I always wanted to be first. So then it started turning to kids racing me. So then it's just a competition. And I always wanted to be like the best wide receiver when I play football. I always wanted to be the best. And I wanted to be the best when I play rugby, and I always want to put my best foot forward. So it's like, how can I take my game to another level? And I honestly, in my head, I think Dan Norton's, no knock because I'm talking to you guys though, but I think Dan Norton's the best winger out there. The dude's just an all-around player, like he can kick. So I need to implement that in my game without just being fast. And then on the defensive side, I mean, just listening to the great coaches that I have from Phil, from Rocky. Rocky definitely helped me take my game to another level on the defensive side. The dude's a genius.
Shout out to Rocky, like the legend.
Dude, yeah, shout out to my man. I call him Little Rock.
We miss him. Shout we miss him.
But, sad times.
And then just things that's going through my head is like, if I'm confident in my kicks, then I'll just do it. If I'm not, then I'm second guessing myself. So then I'm like kind of stuck. But normally I'm just like, man, if I kick it, I just kick it. Just wherever it goes, I know I get there. If it's long, I get there. If it's high, I get there. But just get it away from the defensive side. So that was a little bit that go through my head, like just the confidence I have. Like if I'm feeling confidence with my kicks, then I'll do it, you know? And that's the only reason why I'm doing it now is to get confidence where I can like kick off my left foot now.
Nice.
Yeah, I mean, we had one of our listeners actually ask, he said, we've all got moments of doubt, but have you got a particular image or scene in your mind or a saying that you say to get yourself out of that funk and get you thinking positively? That's if you ever have a moment of doubt.
For sure. I always just think back to why I want to be where I am and then what got me here. So I do that now to this day. Like when I go running, like if I'm running distance and I feel like I'm getting tired, I just start talking to myself, like out loud, like even running past someone, like they're looking at me like I'm crazy. Cause I'm like, just saying like, let's go. That's all I ever say. Let's go. Like, let's do this. Like you've been here before. Let's go. That's all I ever say. Let's go. Like I just started getting like this second wind. I just started getting pumped up and my music started kicking in. I'm just riding, man. But it's just always just like, you just got to battle yourself. Like talk to that voice that you hear in your head, man.
There goes that old crazy PBake talking to himself again.
Yeah.
I wanted to talk about transition athletes, which some people have messaged in about. Obviously, you coming from American football, Carlin's a transition athlete, Nate Ebner for the Olympics. And then this dude you brought on in Vancouver, he's got like a neck as long as Big Bird. It's as thick as a boa constrictor. And he used to be a wrestler. I think he scored like with his first touch of the ball for you guys.
Oh, you're talking about Ben Brazil?
Yeah. That's it. His neck is ridiculous. But you're a team like, you know, with very, very dominant players who are these transition sportsmen. How do you go about finding these players?
Well, I was introduced by my position coach. He was also my guidance counselor and he played for a local men's club. For right now, though, I mean, just the advertising, I mean, like, having Carlin out there, having myself, having people like Danny, people wanting to see these guys, and then they become interested in rugby and they want to pick it up and learn it. I always get people always messaging me like, where can they go to find rugby because it's not in their hometown and things like that. And I always just tell them, go play for a club anywhere because you have old boys clubs all the time. You have clubs all the time around. You just got to find it. Now, the competition might not be there, but for us to pick the game up, you just got to play the game. Just got to start playing the game of rugby and you'll start getting it. You know, for Ben was a wrestler. You always hear like the best athletes to get for rugby are wrestlers or basketball players is what I was told for the game of rugby. I just feel like the more they're seeing it and the more that we keep winning because everyone wants to be a winner and everyone starts seeing that, you know, and it'd be around. So I just think that guys will slowly transition over to want to pick up rugby. And I always tell rugby to me for America that, because everyone has played it, rugby is sandlot football. Like you grew up playing it. The only thing now is that it's structured because you have plays and stuff. You're not just running reckless out there. So I always tell them that because they always want to say like, you don't have pads on. I'm like, you didn't have pads on when you played sandlot football, you know, and you tackled in the grass. You're pushing people down in the middle of the streets. But here it is. Rugby is structured. That's it. So you just got to learn it. And that's how I always explain it to people when they think that it's so dangerous without the pads on. I always just have to explain it to them that way. And I just think that the more, like I said, the more we continue to win and the more that you have guys like the Carlins and the Danny Bears and Ben Pinkelman's doing their job and Martin Iosefo and Falau, it helps the game grow because you have those guys to look up to. And guys that want to transition and want to come play it, you know, because it's a lot of fun. It's not a person I've met that played rugby that didn't fall in love with it. It's not a person I've met that first time they saw rugby, they didn't fall in love with it. Now they're fans. Like I had someone that came to LA for the first time to see rugby, and now they've been wanting to come to all the other games now. They're like, I want to travel now. I want to come watch rugby. I'm a huge fan now. So it's sweet, man. I never met anyone that did not fall in love with it.
That's awesome. Which other athlete then, if you're going to bring someone in to the USA 7 squad right now from another sport, who would you bring in? You pick one.
Ooh, good from any question, sport. Mitch.
I'll bring LeBron James in.
Yeah. It's got to be LeBron.
Got to be.
Good for kickoffs.
I just bring LeBron because he's so big, man. He's an athlete. You know, he played, but they said he could have played football too. He could have been wide receiver. Like, he's just so big, you know, and I just feel like he could learn a game of sevens easily. Nice. Or learn a game of rugby, period.
You have to get him in, PBake. Give him a message. I'm sure he'll get back to you.
I tried to get T.O. to come play, but he was too scared. I tried to get Terrell Owens to come play. He was too scared because he said we didn't have pads on.
Really? Really?
That's amazing.
Do you approach players from NFL who you know, or like young up and comers, and do you try and lobby them to come and play a bit of rugby?
Well, if I like, I was at the Golden Globes little ceremony thing, and he was there, and he was asking what I did.
That's so big time, by the way. Sorry, can we just pick that up? I love that.
He was there, and he was talking about rugby and stuff because he was knowing I was playing rugby, and I was just like, "Hey, man, you can play." Because he was like telling me it's so dangerous. I'm like, "Actually, you played it. You grew up playing sandlot football," and I'm like, "Actually, it's a lot safer than football. You can come play rugby." And he was just like, "Nah, man, y'all don't have pads on, man. Y'all are crazy." I'm like, "I'm telling you, man, you can play rugby. Like, just think about it. It's a lot safer than football." I'm like, "With the pads on, you're invincible because you have a helmet. Take that helmet off, you will not hit the same because you won't last long."
You're talking about transitioning. Is it true Danny Barrett's going to the wrestling after he finishes playing rugby?
You know what? I don't know, but I would love to see it happen. Like, we really be pushing him to go do that. Like, you ought to see him. Like, he loved wrestling. And you should see, like, his little, like, he already have a name, like, for it. Like, Dr. Dano would be his name. Like, it's so cool. Like, he could wrestle, man. I'm serious. Like, he's all about it. And, like, the boys be pushing him up for it all the time. Like, and I even tell him, like, bro, you should go be a wrestler. Like, you can do it, man. I'm telling you, you can.
Natural showman. But like, actually, talking about being a showman, Perry, I mean, rugby traditionally is a conservative game. Certainly it is in England. And I guess the way that you and the Eagles players approach it is slightly different. And I know that sometimes like a couple of people have criticized you before, but no one quite energizes and takes energy from the crowd like you do when you're out.
Well, I think they criticize me a lot, too, because I was a football player. And a lot of rugby fans don't like American football. You know, they think that American football is copying off of rugby. So that's kind of the deal where that comes from. Because honestly, if you look at Kenya, when they score, what type of celebrations do they do? They actually dance.
Everyone
loves it. You know, if you look at NFL, they have so many different type of celebrations. If you look at when I score, what celebrations do I do? So the only thing that you can say is like when I threw up the 200 for the crowd, if you look at that video, my entire family was on that sideline. And that just happened. I wasn't planned in my head to throw up the two or any of that. It's just my family is on the sideline. So I did that for my family. Like my entire family was there. My wife, my sons, my rugby club from back home. So I'm like, this is for you guys. And then when you do stuff like that, like the crowd want to see a personality. Like they don't want to, like the crowd's there to see you guys. Like they don't want to just be boring where you just score. Like when you hear the crowd yelling, they're excited. And like when you do like little things, like I remember one time I did, my son was like, when we first started playing Fortnite, he was like, do the Fortnite stuff. So I'm like, okay. So when I score, I did like the bandage up, take a mini shield for him. Like that was for him because he's sitting back home watching the game. So that was for him. Bandage up, mini shield, this for you, let's go. You know, so it's just things like that. Like whenever you hit a crowd, man, like I'm always feeling and feeding off the crowd, man, because those people come there to watch us. Like if you think about it right now, like how they said they were going to play basketball without the crowd in there, how boring would that be for those athletes in there playing without 100%. A crowd? And watching them on TV with no crowd, that would be so freaking boring. So when they come to watch, I want to give my all, you know, like they sit in the, when we went to Australia, it was freaking so hot out there, but the fans sat there and watched us, you know, in the rain. They sit there and watch us in the rain. So it's so cool, like, to just interact with the fans and give back, you know? Whatever I do, I don't know what I do, but whatever I choose to do, when I do it, it's like, it's going off the crowd. Like, when I did the, like, they got mad, and it was like, he think he's the man of rugby. When I did the little Sarevi ball, running with the ball in my hand. Not at all. I did that because Sarevi inspired me so much, and he was at that game, and that tournament, rather, and it was just something to give back to him. It was a tribute to him. Like, you inspired me to play rugby. Like, the game is so big because of you and the things that you do. So, like, I want to be the best, and he was the best. Like, you look at Michael Jordan, everyone stick their tongue out and stuff. They do stuff from the best. Like, everyone takes stuff from the best there is, you know, and implement in their game and do whatever they do. So, I mean, that's where that stuff comes from. And some of the times, though, honestly, stuff comes from the doubters, you know, like, take that. Take that, like, the people who didn't believe, the people who hate, take that. This is for you, you know, kind of deal. Like, everyone have that in them. Like, oh, that's just the way nature is, man. And that's just how I roll, man. I just wear my heart on my sleeves, man. So
you got to quote Taylor Swift. Haters gonna hate, 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 hate. Leave them to
Taylor
it,
Taylor Swift's my girl, man. You know it.
Dude, you met her at the Golden Globes, didn't you?
No, I didn't.
I think that Hong Kong moment as well, mate. If there's anyone in the game of sevens at the moment who's earned the right to do the Sarevi celebration, it's definitely you. What was that like? Just not to kind of make you blush here, but two World Player of the Year awards on the bounce. What was that like being named as the top guy 2 years in a row, flying high? How did that feel? Like, was it scary being kind of at the top for that long as well?
Honestly, man, I never seen it coming, for real. I just wish that when things like that come around, like awards like that come around, I just wish that you can take your entire team with you. Because if you look at, like, a lot of my tries, my teammates are putting me away with space, or they've done all the hard part, all the hard work, and they just offload it to me and say, okay, go walk in. You know, so when those awards come about, it's like, man, this, the first one, definitely, like, this is my teammate, this is for you guys, man. You guys did this, not me, you know. And then just the second one is like, man, this is for my family, this is for everyone believed in me. Of course it's my teammates though, but just everyone that believed in me and that's been behind me and pushing me, you know, like, who said that this could be done. So I mean, I never looked at it like being like on a pedestal or any of that. Just like, I'm just playing a game of rugby, I'm just having fun, you know, and everything that comes with it, you know. So it's like, when you putting in your hard work, you don't know what can come off of it until it comes, you know. So then it just allows you to look back and be like, man, hard work does pay off, you know, and it feels good when you look back at it.
Hey, one more question from Instagram then, PBake, talking about hard work. What's your routine in between games? Like, how do you chill out, and what do you eat, and a quick one. What do you do in between games?
So I don't eat in between games. I will pound a protein shake, and I might have like a little bit of Gatorade, a little sips of water, but I just like hang out, man. I just lounge around, listen to music the entire time, but I can't eat. I feel like if I eat, I get sluggish, man. I'll be too full.
And maybe I'll take that advice for next year, hopefully, if I've got a contract. That must be where I'm going wrong.
You need to take that advice in quarantine, man.
Oh god,
amazing. Oh, a random Insta question. I think if you could play for any other team on the series, who would you play for? If you had to pick another team, who'd you jump into?
I jump in with Fiji, and the only reason why I jump in with Fiji is because their ball control is so crazy. Like, they just be offloading everything. I remember one time Pat Revolvo came to Tiger Academy and he played for Rugby Town. And I was just out there running around with him. And just his ball movement and just the way he just get rid of the ball. And it's like right there. It was crazy. I'm like, man, I can get used to this.
Nice.
Perry, did you find, coming from a non-rugby background, that you didn't have a preconception about any of these teams? So you mentioned Fiji, their ball control. Like, everyone who has grown up with rugby knows who Fiji are. They know what they're about. Whereas you would have come in not really knowing anything about any of these nations. So you would have just been playing who's in front of you?
Correct. And the only team I actually heard about, and it wasn't even a sevens team, but I just thought they were all the same, was the All Blacks. Because that's what everyone hollers, the All Blacks. Like, even right now, if someone said, oh, I've heard of rugby, I'm like, what did you hear? Oh, I just know of the All Blacks. That's it. You know, so when I came on, that's the only team I heard of was the All Blacks. But of course, they were referencing to the 15th side, you know. That's all it is, too, when you have teams like that. I mean, I remember when Mike Friday came, that was like the biggest message he gave to us. And they're just guys in a jersey, the same as you guys. And some of the times they had come with young kids on there, too, that's like 18 years old. He'd be like, these are young kids. Like, they're the same. It's just a shirt. You're playing a shirt, guys. And I guess once we started believing and got over that hump, then we can compete with any of them.
Yeah, what's Mike Friday like to play under, Perry?
He's a great guy, first of all. He likes to joke. He knows how to be serious when it's time to put in that work. And he's pretty smart. He's a great coach for real. And he'll go to war for his players, seriously. It's all about his players for real at the end of the day. And he'll do anything for you. So for some reason, I've just always been blessed to be around great coaches, man. In every sport I've been in, my coaches have really been good to me.
What's just last one for me, Perry? I don't know how the other guys are going with the questions, but I'm just keen to know, like, however many years you say you reckon you got a few years left in you in your career, what's the dream? Like, what do you want to do before you have to hang up the boots?
So the main one for me is win a medal, stand on a podium at Tokyo 2021. And then the other one is to win a World Cup, because then I feel like everything will be accomplished that I wanted to do, kind of deal.
Nice.
Good goals. Good goals then, PBake.
The only reason I want to really win a World Cup is I want to rub it in Phil's green in face, because every time he come in, that's the only thing he talk about is him winning a premiership. He always showing his rings off. And he always just talking crap to us about his rings.
Well, so obviously it's the medals, it's the World Cup. You clearly want to leave a legacy. How far do you reckon there's boys now who are athletes, young athletes in the States who are saying, I want to be a rugby player. I want to be a rugby sevens player. They're not just saying, I want to be a footballer or an NBA star. They're saying, I want to be a USA Eagle. Do you think that the game's getting to that level in terms of sevens out there?
It definitely is. actually, the hard part is where kids who are picking up rugby, they're actually leaving their sports, and it's making the coaches upset. Like football coaches, I know of a high school who coached football, doesn't want his kids to go play rugby at all, because some of them are actually leaving to go play rugby. And I just think that is so cool for them to go experience it, for one, because you get to travel the world, not just inside the States. You get to travel the world. And I know kids will enjoy that and love that. Like, I've never thought, me coming from my small town, I'll be traveling the world, you know, and getting to see other cultures and things like that. So I think it's just, in due time, it'll start happening. You know, and kids are definitely already talking about it. They want to, like, where I go and train at right now is kids that are, they're 18 years old, and they're saying, we want to play for the Eagles one day. Like, we want to play sevens one day for the national team. Like, and that's so freaking cool. And they're like, is it hard? Or what can I do? How can I get there? And I just think it's so cool now that you're getting that and hearing that. Because when I was 18, I didn't hear nothing about rugby and playing for no Eagles, sevens, none of that. At all. Even when I was 24, I didn't hear about playing with it, you know? The only thing that triggered me to pull the trigger to go play was being Olympian, you know? But now all that has changed now. Like, I wish I could have done this years ago. That's why it's like, for me right now, like, when I think about it, it was like, because I went to Rio 2016, you know, and everyone's like, you're an Olympian. Like, yes, I'm Olympian, but I'm not an Olympian because I don't have that medal. Like, all the names you named, they all have medals. And that's what the Olympics is about. Like, being in our own village, everyone's on one goal there. And that's to go get medals, you know, and to walk away without it. It's just like, man, I'm Olympian, but I'm not. And like, I want that medal so I can be associated with those names and like show my medal off. Like, that's so cool. You know, like, one thing you can't take from someone is their achievements, and achievements of like being an Olympian, but have the medal to represent to show it. You know, like, even when I'm dead and gone, my medal will still be hanging around somewhere. Someone will have it. My kids, grandkids will have it or something, you know. And that's why it drives me so hard to want to get that medal.
Well, hopefully, Perry, me and Chippy will be there trying to stop you getting one, man.
Hey, man, go ahead and share it, man. You guys already got one. Hey, man, you already stopped us from the World Cup, man. Cross kick Mitch.
That was good, wasn't it?
It was one of those moments.
That was good.
Yeah. Man, that was crazy. What's up?
I remember in the tunnel before that World Cup game, and you were all going, "We're dogs. This is our house. This is ours." And then I was listening. I was looking at the crowd. I was like, "This is pretty cool." And then Carlin slapped me on the bum, and he was like, "What's up, baby?" I was like, "Fucking hell! Here we go. Here we go." I was laughing. You bloody good lads.
That was the final, man. Like, we went into OT and stuff. That was crazy, man. And the crowd was phenomenal. It was dope, man.
That was one of the best games I've ever played. Like, I just enjoyed that game so much. I remember that.
Class.
Look, Perry, we can't let you go without hearing a little bit about your speed training, because loads of people want to hear about it. They want to know what kind of things you do, how frequently you hit your speed training compared to other rugby ball skills, etc. You just give us a little taste, because there's loads of people out there who want to learn how to be as fast as the speed stick.
All right, Big Rich can back me up since he's so fast. He knows.
That's it.
But
cheers, PBake.
But it just depends. It varies. Like, some days I'll run 60s or 80s sprints with Carlin. There'll be time, so we'll be running against time. Sometimes I'll run with the sled. I'll run with bands. I'll push against the sled. Everything's normally always timed, though. Doing agility stuff, like running and making a cut at the blink of a light kind of deals. Like, we run through these like gates and they have lights on it. It just all depends, man. Like, bounding work, holding the band around the waist and doing drives, anklings, knee drives. I don't know. It's a lot. It just depends on, I guess, the day it is, of the week it is, and what I didn't do the last week, I do this week kind of deal.
Does your training differ quite a lot from that of Carlin's, because you're two very differently designed athletes?
Yes, because he's a track star. Yes, it does. Like, that guy, I'm serious. I've never seen no one work as much as Carlin and work as hard as Carlin. And that's no lie. Like, he will go through a hard, hard day of training, like a high intensity day of training. And we train like 3 times a day. So we'll finish up at like probably 4 o'clock. But in between that break, that lunch break, Carlin's down at the track running 200 meter sprints and stuff, like running with the track team down there. Like, this dude never stops. And I don't know how he does it. Like,
how does he stay in one piece? How come his body doesn't break down?
I have no idea. I don't know. I don't know what he does, but that dude does not stop running. Like, it got to the point where the coach used to tell him, like, "You're not allowed to go to the track. You're not allowed to go to the track today." Like, that's why you're feeling. But this dude don't stop, man. Like, he'll be at the track and, like, we'll show up at the center to start training. Carlin's been there since 6 o'clock, already running at the track. Like, I kid you not, he doesn't stop.
Whatever you're doing is working. Don't change.
Right.
Thanks very much for coming on, PBake.
No doubt, man. Thanks for having me, boys.
Perry, absolute legend, mate. Top bloke, top player.
That's it, PBake. Hey, keep safe. Keep safe, mate. Great to speak to you.
We'll do, guys.
PBake, what a legend. Thank you so much, man.
Thanks again. Amazing. Guys. Cheers.
Cheers.
Cheers, boss.
See you, mate.
Awesome. One night in heaven, one night in heaven. I mean, it's one thing having a big name and like try scoring superstar, but what a lovely bloke. What a top lad to get on.
Top geezer.
I said, Chippy, we should get some knobheads on to make us look better next time. So if we get someone like Perry on, who's such a good bloke as well as a great player, it's going to make us look bad.
There was a pang of panic when he went on a roll, and I was just so captivated by what he was saying. I suddenly thought, oh my God, are we recording this? Director Tom's on the case. Tom. Thank God, that could have been the biggest mistake of my professional career. Tell you what,
that was brilliant.
Chip, you are just no lube de Carpentier, straight into the US bankruptcy. Is your job all right?
Like, yeah,
fuck it.
Just no beating around the bush, no softening them up, just straight in with the sledgehammer.
Mate, we're all worried. We're all worried. I've got 2 months left, as I've told you. We need to know what's going on. Obviously, we've been speaking to other players from Sevens, and like, Australia are in a bit of trouble at the moment with their rugby union. USA are in trouble as well. No one really knows if there's an out at the end of this COVID-19. Not want to put a downer on it. I know a couple of the USA lads are injured and their physios aren't working there anymore. Who knows? Yeah, it's a bit of a scary time. But we've got to pick the positives out of this. We're going to kick on. We're giving you a great podcast to listen to. Share it with all your mates.
It's quite nice to chat to someone from another team, isn't it? Because like, it kind of brings home that there are other teams affected by this. Everyone's in the same boat. Everyone's got an uncertain future.
Tell me, I'm interested, chaps. What's it like for you two to be speaking with an opposition player so candidly and so openly?
Mate, I think it's different in sevens to probably what it is in 15s and certainly a lot of other sports, I'm sure. We, as a collection of players, all from different teams, I think, are pretty open at the best of times because of that situation where you go away and you live with each other in the same hotels and you mix a lot anyway. So you can't be this super guarded, you know, block all the other teams out type person because it's just exhausting. So I think that that's kind of becomes ingrained in you if you've been on the series for a couple of years. I think there are still some guys who'd rather keep opposition teams at arm's length. But personally, I feel like you don't benefit from the series as much if that's your attitude. So I think there's quite a lot of that that plays into our mindsets in terms of chatting.
And in 15s, you play a team like 1 week and then you're not playing them again for another 6 months. Like sometimes you can play people twice in a weekend and then you play them the next weekend and then you go for a beer with them. And as Mitch said, you're eating with them, you're seeing them in lifts. Like if you're not willing to be open and honest and like have a chat and just be yourself, it's going to drain all your energy throughout the weeks. Like if you're trying to put on this persona that you're like, you don't want to speak to anyone and you're not like a social person, unless that is you, then it's just going to drain your energy. It's too much hard work.
Yeah, because I wonder whether there is a performance edge to being like, right, I'm going to be spending the whole week. I know who I'm playing at the weekend. Can I get in their heads? Can I really throw them off their game and, I don't know, start doing weird shit in the lifts or whatever, or dropping little, I don't know, fake farts. Tactics around.
Oh,
dropping farts in the lift.
Sorry, I thought you said...
But I think it's just the drain on yourself would just be over and above any positive effect that you'd get.
That's it. Scott Riddell was one for that. Like, me and him got on like a house on fire in the Team GB stuff. He's like proper grumpy, like just right up my street. You know what I mean? But he, like, I don't know if it was just the English, but in a tournament week when we were playing them, he wouldn't speak to me at all, even though I'd been texting him a couple of weeks before. Tournament week, wouldn't speak to me, wouldn't look at me, wouldn't do anything, and like wouldn't hold his farts in the lift, like just it's a weird one, like a top bloke, but must be hard to, maybe it's the Scottish English thing, I don't know.
Do you know, I was in Cape Town with a mate and where the Sevens was on at that time, and we ran into the Scottish team and Scott Riddell was one of them, and he made me take my shirt off in Caprice and then basically ridiculed my rig in front of everyone in Caprice at about midnight with the rest of the Scottish boys just pointing at me. It was
that's amazing.
Humiliating experience. It's the only time I've ever met. Only Scott. Time I've ever known the guy.
Scott Riddell has gone up in my estimations even more. I already thought he was a top bloke, but that is brilliant.
But yes, do you think, are there teams that engage in the Sevens fraternity and others who don't? And the ones who don't, do you think it's to their detriment, to their experience of the World Series?
I'm trying to think of one team. Mitch, the only thing I think of is Russia. But even then, there's a couple of Russian lads who give you a nod. But I'm not sure if that's a language barrier.
I think sometimes it's a language barrier. I think generally everyone's pretty friendly and pretty willing to mix. Like obviously there are some guys who aren't interested. They want to go out there, win rugby games. Like you're probably going to favor spending time with your own team because they're your mates most of the time. But and I think it's only as I've got older that I've really valued probably chatting to the other teams. I think I always thought it was a really cool thing, but there were times when I was a little bit, I didn't put the effort into it, certainly. Whereas now I'm much more inclined to try and create those relationships with other players from other teams because they come from different cultures, speak different languages, like completely different life experience. And it'd be foolish not to try and make the most of that.
100%. I think my first couple of years on sevens, maybe first year when I was in and out with 15s, I was still in that 15s mindset. And I'd see someone in a lift. I'd like puff my chest out and I wouldn't look at him. I'd look dead straight ahead, and if they said hello, I'd give them a nod. And it's just like, looking back, what an idiot. I must have looked like a dick for one. And
it's
two,
just an
like,
experience, isn't it?
Yeah.
And the other thing is, nice. As soon as, when there's other, like little things happen, like when you get injured, for example, everyone's so friendly, asking if you're all right, you know, what's the diagnosis, things like that, helping you out around the hotel. You know, if you've won the tournament, people are super friendly, congratulating you. So little moments like that really kind of feed into the group camaraderie of the series. One night in
heaven, one night. Right, time for a bit of Nause's corner.
Are you ready for it? I feel like we've had a lack of banter that this might send you over the edge into sleep.
No, Mitch, I'm banging for it.
The clue to this week's edition of Nause's Corner is the fact that Mitch has come dressed as a psychiatrist. So get ready to recline on the chaise longue and let Mitch delve into your deepest, darkest emotions.
Well, funny you say psychiatrist, because actually the subject of today's Nause's Corner is motivation. Obviously, this is something that's come to the fore in lockdown. Motivation levels around the country are an all-time low, I suspect, particularly amongst the country's athletes. I certainly have had the demons on the shoulder every time I've gone to do a session telling me to shave off reps, shave a set. No one's going to know. What's the point? What are you training for? These are the demons that have been going round and round. So I just thought I'd talk about a couple of sources of motivation that we talk about. Obviously, we've mentioned a couple of times on the pod the importance of the psychology of the game. And where you get your motivation from is super important, because not just for training, which we do every day, and Perry mentioned that a lot about his drive to go out and train, but also across a tournament, when you get to game six, especially week two, you need to tap into something. So even though people think, oh, surely you don't need motivation to go out there, I tell you, when you're battered and your body's telling you you don't want to play anymore, you need to tap into something. To get yourself into the right frame of mind to go and play top level sevens. So the first one I picked out as a source of motivation is the kind of fear. So I guess this is the whip side. And this might be fear of what other teams are doing in their training, fear of falling short of where you want to get to. Now that can be a pretty powerful motivator, but I think it's also a bit of a risky one, because you kind of comes into the fear of failure thing, which can have negative consequences in terms of not trying things on the field. So the next source of motivation that we kind of see quite a lot is sort of the gratitude side. This is something that I particularly really enjoy. So realizing how fortunate I am to be playing the game, how fortunate I am to be around the world doing it, to be there with such good people. So it's often tapping into like, what my opportunity here? So when you're in lockdown, that might be... my opportunity to feel good is go and do my session, something like that. Another one, which Perry talked about a lot really powerfully, was the end goal. So, you know, the trophy, the World Cup trophy, or getting a medal at the Olympic Games. Again, those for a lot of people are their motivating factors. They're way ahead, something that they're striving for, often tangible things like that. But I think underpinning a lot of these things, and the number one that we talk about in our England squad, is kind of what's your why. So that's the phrase that we often use, what's your why? And this varies from person to person. They do it for different reasons. This is always kind of really underpinned by your values and what kind of person you want to be. And as a motivating factor, is as a result, incredibly powerful, incredibly strong, and will stand through the test of time. So for me, that's kind of the love of the game, the love of the people I do it for, including the players and the people that might be inspired by what we do. So there's a couple of things that you kind of tap into. And it's particularly interesting, I guess, from my standpoint as a captain, as a leader, trying to use these kind of different sources of motivation to try and get the best out of people and get the best out of the other players. So flipping it to you guys to contribute. I hope you enjoyed that little rundown. I hope you've prepared your top. What do you look to as a motivational quote or saying to kind of get those juices flowing when you need it most?
Chip, he will come you to shoot? You first. Okay, oh, coming to me first. So
Chip, yours is probably like etched in a coal mine somewhere that's, you know, been passed down from your family, through your family.
No, mate, don't be so, what's the word? It's not racist, is it, to be harsh to northerners? You shouldn't associate the north with with coal mines.
Northerners. Be the canary. So
we do a lot of work, well, with Katie Warriner, who's our sports site. And she told us a couple of years ago about your why. So like whenever I'm struggling or thinking, it's my why. So like why I play rugby, like my family, Annika, Rudy, everything like at home. And then for a quote, what I picked up a couple of years ago was from Rory Best. He said, "You don't get what you deserve, you get what you work for." And nice. That makes me like, so because it's sometimes you think, oh, I should be like, should be playing this week. Oh, I've been here for whatever, or like I deserve to go to the Olympics. But like, it doesn't, you don't get what you deserve. You get what you work for and get what you put in. And that just keeps you honest, keeps you like, there's no like fighting with that one. You just do what you need to do. Get it done.
Nice. Bernsey, what about you?
I mean, I know that you asked us to think about our quote before the show, but I didn't realize we were going to be talking about our feelings quite as much, which, as you know, I feel uncomfortable doing. So maybe not quite as much thought has gone into mine. But my quote that I stick by, I really believe in as well, is Wayne Gretzky said, "You miss 100% of the shots you don't take." And another one that goes hand in hand with that is "Build it and they will come." And I know that "build it and they will come" is a bit of a throwaway remark. It's quite banterous, but it's absolutely true. And Wayne Gretzky's right too, that I think that our society is one that maybe doesn't embrace failure enough. And that if you don't try, then you never know. And I'd say that this podcast is probably my best example that I was tentative to start it with initially. Obviously, you boys came on board and we've done it together. But, you know, since dipping that toe into the unknown, then you put a foot in and suddenly you're plunging in and having a nice little dip in moderate success, well, or failure, depending on how you look at it. But I just
think
the water
is tepid.
Nothing's going to come to you. You got to put it in the air and give it a swing, and hopefully it goes over the fence.
I love that, Bernsey. I really like that a lot.
Also, very good. I think that quote was Michael Jordan, wasn't it?
Michael Jordan's one is that I've missed this many three-pointers,
missed a load of shots.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
There's another one from Jordan actually said that he was on about, it's quite cool sometimes, he talked about when he goes out to play a game, he doesn't know if someone's there for their one and only game they'll ever watch him. So he wants to kind of put a show on for them, which is interesting mindset harking back to what Perry was saying. He's obviously tuned into something similar for himself, the way he reacts to the crowd. I thought that was pretty cool.
Sweet. Well, that's interesting.
That's me, lads. That's Nause's corner.
That's interesting as well, though, because that can be a positive and a negative, because you're the center of your own narrative. And that comes back to the failure thing, that when you try something, you're terrified of failing because you think people are going to look at you and say, "Oh, look at him. He tried that and he failed. He's useless." When really, probably no one's paying attention. You're the only hero in your romance novel, ultimately. Mm. So that can cripple you. But Michael Jordan has harnessed that in a positive way to say, "I'm the star of the show. Everyone's here to see me. The onus is on me to perform for them. And I'm going to do it every time."
Absolutely. And to wrap up the Nause's corner, actually, the motivation is as effective as you're able to frame it. Recently, Tom Farrow used a nice little line, was that life is the stories we tell ourselves. And that's exactly the same in motivation. You use whatever you can to achieve what you want. But certain strategies, I will say, I think are beneficial over the long term, and some are better for the short term. But you've got to experiment to find out.
That's good. And that's a good way to wrap this up. Take that into your quarantine week.
Yeah. Have a good week, everyone. Get what you need to out of it, even if that is glove boxing.
Yeah,
hot boxing.
Don't go glove boxing every day, but sometimes a bit of glove boxing is good for the soul. That's my takeaway from this week in quarantine.
And that's the message of the podcast this week.
Boys, what a pleasure to link up with you again. And once again, PBake, nothing but love for that guy. What a guest.
Big
what
man.
A bloke. Loved
Amazing.
Having him up in the clouds. One more reminder
what
to our listeners. If you enjoy this pod, please like, subscribe, review, and try and propel us up the charts so that the seventh heaven message is spread to a few more eardrums. But until next time, it is adios.
See you there.
Bye.